Games in this podcast range from E to M. Hi, it's Larry Hryb, Xbox's Major Nelson. Welcome to the official Xbox podcast. Thank you for liking, subscribing, and hitting that little notification button on whatever device you're on. We've got the full gang here, and if I hit this button, here they all come. Boom! Hello, everybody.
Good button pushing.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes, nice work.
We're back. We're back. I know some would say we're back in our boxes where we belong. Last week we were live in studio, but now we're back in our individual boxes. It's great to see you. Hopefully, Rebecca, you had a safe trip back to New York City.
Yes, it was so nice to see you guys, though. I know, really far, plus 3 hours. Yeah, it was awesome hanging out with you guys last week. I really enjoy doing the in-person podcasts. I just feel like it's so much easier for us to talk without that little, like, oh, is he going to say something?
That transcontinental lag.
Yeah. Oh, and I wanted to mention, if anyone missed it last week, we do try to tweet out like a day or two in advance. So if you want to follow us on our socials so that you can catch our live episode next time and chat with us, please
there they
do
all
so.
Are.
It That's was, a... yeah, it was cool seeing all the chat. So
yeah,
it's a lot landed of fun. The plug. Anyone working on a book or a movie they want to promote?
Yes, in fact, both of those, but we'll talk about that later. We've got,
Larry, if you don't write a book, eventually it will be very,
everybody difficult. Says I should write a book. What I mean, I've already got kind of the outline of what it should be, you know, and I've got an interesting work.
You're halfway
title.
There.
I guess I feel like
it has to be an audio book at least, like, or like, ooh. You know, cause you have such a great voice.
Oh, you're very
It
kind.
Would just be such a shame to have to read and imagine your
I'll
voice.
I'll put it up on Audible as a, maybe that's the only way it's yes. available is an audio book.
Yeah. So. Did you have a working title? I feel like
I don't want to talk about it, but I do have a little bit of a working title. So we'll just leave it at that. But we're not.
Is it called, this is Xbox Alliance Major Nelson. Is it?
Yeah, that seems fitting.
Anyway.
All right. Sorry, Larry.
that's great. No, I'm just glad we got everybody back together. We're going to talk a little bit about what we're playing. I'll start with Jeff, because I think you know, if we go full screen on you can kind of see what you and I are playing, and that is, ta-da!
Yeah, we got into season two. You see those numbers are really low because we record this in the middle of the week, so it's been less than a day, but we were hopped in. It was great playing the new modes. Had a good time with King of the Hill, except for the times where we really got stomped. Really know who is the better team very quickly, I would say.
Well, wait a minute. It's not fair, because our first game, we were just figuring it out, you know, because there's new dynamics and so forth. The second game, boom, we nailed it.
Yes, we did. And then you left, and then we played like three more and lost all three. So you know very quickly if you're outclassed is what I would say.
Well, let's be clear. The irony is I had to leave to get ready to prepare for the interview about Halo that we're going to play later on.
Yes, so we're looking forward to hearing from Tom French later today to talk about season two, Lone Wolves, which is now available for Halo Infinite. And I hope you talk about this other mode, which I ended up playing after everyone else went to bed. I was playing a little later, playing Last Spartan Standing.
You were playing by yourself or playing with yourself?
Yeah, which is sort of like a mini solo battle royale in a way, where there is one last Spartan standing at the end. And
there's actually a zone that closes in on you, if I recall correctly.
Exactly. It, not as quickly. It doesn't like you have a set amount of lives. And so it's not like you're taken out once and you're gone. It is definitely not like a traditional battle royale by any means, but there's definitely things in common with it. And so once your lives are gone, then you're down to one, and then there will be at the end one last Spartan standing. It yep. was never me, but it was really cool.
Did you get close?
Here's the other part, because like, you know, when you think of a battle royale, it's like, oh, you land and then you're looking, and there's like a luck element in terms of finding weapons and stuff like that. Instead, here you start off with two pistols, both the, and I'll get the name wrong, but the electrical pistol. And,
the one that's essential that I found to be useless.
Yes.
It's like fly swatter.
One man's trash. Right,
yes, exactly. And then once you get your first limb, then you hold down X, you can level up, and then you move up to the brute pistol, right. The one with the blades on the end. And then after that, it moves up again, and you get the AR, and then after that, you get the BR. Anyway, so the further it goes, like, the more well-armed everybody is. And anyway, I found that really fun. I think I'll be playing a lot of that, but it is a solo mode. So it's one of those things where when I'm waiting for everyone else to get online, or before, or if you all drop off, I'll be jumping into that. At some point, I have to get a win. That's statistically, it has to happen.
Good. Well, that's fun. Check that out. Well, we're going to talk all about the Halo Season 2 Lone Wolves later on. As you said, I have some time with Tom Wolf that I was able to chat with him about. Tom Wolf. What does that mean? Lone Wolves, Tom
Lone
French.
Lone Wolves, Tom French. Very good. Pardon
Both names sound nice.
Yes. Two other games just really want to talk about quickly. One, both are part of Xbox Game Pass and recently released. One is Bugsnax. We had talked about that. This is a strange game.
I played it.
Yeah. All right. Well, I would love to hear your thoughts on it. Well, okay, great. All I can think of is French Fry Spider. That's like what has stuck in my head.
Well, I will say I played it, but we have a clip here, Rebecca, because you played it as well, but it looks like you played it a lot longer than I did. Should I roll that clip?
Let's see it.
Sure. It's a very basic clip. This is like, okay. So I just wanted to take a clip of something.
You're harvesting ketchup.
It was kind of cute. Yeah. So with this one, what's its name? Bunger. It's like a little hamburger bug. And it really loves ketchup. I wish you could hear the audio because it's like bunger, 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 bunger. Like that's the noise it makes. Oh, sure. Let me voice the animal and then add the audio.
Let's go back to the. Let's play that again. Hold on. Let's play that again. There he is.
All right. Can you guys please rate my imitation of the bunger? It's been good, right?
One more time.
I thought it was great.
Bunger, bunger.
Perfect.
I give it 4 ketchup packets out of 5.
Yes.
Thank you. All right. That works. So I wanted to try this one out after we talked about it on the show last week because it just came to Game Pass. And I absolutely loved Viva Pinata, I think summer of 2010 or something like that. That was just all that I did. That's not when it came out. I played it a couple years later, 360 back at the time. But
explain what Bugsnax is because a lot of people may not, from that clip, may not get it. It's a resource game. Yeah. Talk about it.
So that's the problem. It's kind of weird. Someone else described it on a meeting that I was
in. One person's problem, another person's treasure.
Yeah. So someone else tried to describe it on Monday in a meeting that I was in, and she said it's part Viva Pinata, but part kind of like not cannibal, but it's just kind of macabre. You know, it's like bizarre in a kind of dark way, but. So what attracted it to me was I thought it was going to be kind of like Viva Pinata, which was this really cute Xbox 360 game where you were on this animal and you tried to get different.
Yeah,
so good. You tried to get different pinatas to like meet with each other and you got like little prizes and you took care of a yard and it was really nice. So this one is kind of similar in that there's like different animals like bugs, but each of the bugs are like snacks. So like the bunger was obviously like a hamburger and then he's really attracted to the ketchup. But it's kind of dark. Like you kind of go around doing these tasks for the inhabitants of this island. And it's almost like a mystery because you're trying to find the woman the person who invited you there. But then you're kind of like, you know, dealing with the residents along the way. So I actually haven't finished the game, so I don't know the whole mystery yet. But the kind of dark part of it is that you catch the snacks and then you like feed them to the residents and then the residents will like start to turn into the snack and it's
disturbing.
It's kind of thank you.
It is.
Yes. So I don't know if I'm gonna finish this game. I was like, oh, I thought it was gonna be cute and light like Viva Pinata, but it's a little dark. I don't know.
So what, your legs to turn into strawberries and your arm to turn into a French
fry? Begs the question, which we're not prepared, that you guys are not prepared. This is fully unscripted. Jeff, what would you be turning into? What do you eat a lot of and what would you turn into?
I mean, one could debatably say that having not been able to go into a gym for the last 2 years, my arms have already turned into noodles. So there's a very good, I should probably be wearing long sleeves until I rectify that situation. I would say, I mean, I really do eat a lot of noodles. So
you do.
So why don't we just go with like udon noodle limbs is where I would probably land.
Now, Rebecca, what would you turn into? Because you're every time I look on your Instagram, you're at some fantastic meal, or at least it photographs well. Tell me what you would be.
I mean, honestly, noodles are my favorite. So, Jeff, thank you for stealing that one, which is why my gamer tag is Grumpy Ramen.
That's right.
But I actually don't eat that much ramen these days because now that I'm getting older, I'm like, oh, it's not that healthy. I'd probably turn into like pizza or tacos. Yeah.
Oh, those are healthy. Standard. Yeah.
That's good. Yeah.
See, now.
Sorry, I'm kind of contradictory.
Now, Rebecca, you stole Larry. Mine because I was going to say I turned into a pizza, but you stole mine. So Jeff stole yours, you stole mine, and that's just the way it goes.
Back to the Larry saying it's unscripted. We should have talked through this at some point.
But it just really – anyway, so back to Bugsnax.
Yeah, I just had one more thought. I mean, I think the reason I don't want to play is because I don't want to know the answer to this question, but it's like so as you like help the residents, they start to – and you give them like snacks – they turn into those snacks. So then I'm wondering, are the snacks that are around, are those previously people that
Soylent
like
Green? It's people.
I know, that's what I was thinking. Soylent Green. Yeah. So I'm like, oh, this is too much for me. So I don't know. But you guys have played it?
I thought the same thing. I was just wondering, like, how far is this going to go? Because like one person's like, you feed him. And it's funny, like, because your character, who's like a journalist, like very much recoils when that first person, the mayor's leg turns into a strawberry. And he's like, you want more? Okay.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's disturbing, but it's fun. And so, I like the idea that it was like, there's like puzzle solving. So like to catch the bunger is too powerful for this trap that you have. Yep. So you have to use the ketchup to make a bunger hit another bunger so that they, sort of like knock each other out and then you can capture them. So, I can imagine like that's going to progress and, sort of the puzzle solving element seemed really fun. And I would say it feels like a lot of like effort went into the sound design on this. That's like in your head. And so anyway, well done. I think I'll keep playing it until at some point I get entirely too disturbed.
Bugsnax. Check it out now on Game Pass.
Oh, one boy. More new to Game Pass that came out this week. So Bugsnax hit last week. Loot River is now available as part of
Loot River.
Yes, that's the theme song. How did you know? Loot River was described. I want to say it was Paris Lily on Twitter called it a mixture of Dark Souls and Tetris, and I was like, what? And that's actually a really good description. So it is a top down, I would say, pixel art. Action game where the controls are very much in the vein of a Souls-like, with like right bumper is a quick attack and right trigger is more of a heavy attack, and you dodge with A, and so a lot of those same sort of moves, but it is top down. The Tetris part is all the game that I've played so far takes place on these floating platforms on the eponymous Loot River, one would imagine. And when you're on a platform, you can steer it using the D-pad. And so what you do is like,
thus
you'll be on
thus
a platform.
The Tetris angle, is that what you're
exactly. So sometimes you have to figure out, how do I make this platform be able to continue moving? That platform has enemies on it. Well, how can I orient it in such a way that the enemies I'll be able to control when I engage with the enemy. So they're all maybe funneled into a line or something like that, instead of just like, you know, blundering into a situation that I'm not going to win. So challenging game, really a lot of elements that are Souls-like. So when you die, you go into this town, you can sort of level up over time and acquire new weapons and things like that. It seems really interesting and some good buzz on that one. So Loot River, check it out. Part of Game Pass, it's waiting for you. And if, you know, you've already got access to it.
We kind of seamlessly, by the way, Jeff, well done. We seamlessly went to what we're playing kind of right into the news section. It was in case you missed it.
Well, what else are you playing? I would love to hear.
No, I mean, that's kind of it. I mean, Halo. We talked about Halo. We talked about Bugsnax. I think that's kind of all that I'm playing right now. I mean, it's been it's been fun. I've just been waiting for a Halo. Oh, last week I did some Sea of Thieves in the Pirate Legend event they were doing. So I did that with a bunch of us, and that was a three hour voyage on Saturday night. That really
3 hour tour.
It was fun.
70s reference.
It was fun. That was just the fun stuff.
So just to keep it on the Sea of Thieves topic here, the next event they're going to be doing is a community day. And that's going to be on May 14th, so next weekend. depending on when you're listening to this. And they will be Twitch drops. If you watch the streamers that are participating, there'll be login bonuses, in-game sales, and in a renown multiplier that climbs the as you tweet. So Rare teams always think of interesting ways to make the game more social and have that lead to rewards within the game. And you'll see that in a really big way with the Sea of Thieves Community Day, May 14th.
Have you seen the Sea of Thieves merchandise they have?
No, is it cute?
Do tell.
They've got the yeah. standard stuff, the shirts and the hats, but they have, and I've asked for them to send me one so I can show it off, a Sea of Thieves version of Monopoly.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
And okay. I was really impressed. It's called the Sea of Thieves. It looks like it's at Walmart too, for those of you in the US. But I was thinking about
go to the brig. Go directly to the brig. Do not Costco.
It looks like you still have to go free park. Although free parking in Sea of Thieves, I don't know what that means. But yeah, you should go to the brig.
Free moorage. Yeah.
That's
where they really get you.
Before we get into the interviews, Rebecca, you had a little bit of something you want to talk about for right off the bat, right?
Yeah. So this month is a cultural moment near and dear to my heart. This month is Asian and Pacific Islander Heritage Month. Last year, I had on the co-leads of Asians at Xbox just to chat about what we were doing through the month, and that was really great. If you're curious about how you can support the Asian and Pacific Islander American communities in the U.S., head over to Xbox Wire. We have, you know, as usual, we have a few different ways that people can donate their Microsoft Rewards points to organizations that are helping Asian and Pacific Islander communities within the U.S. Next week, we have a bunch of Twitch streams featuring Asian and Pacific Islander creators. They're going to be doing takeovers on the Xbox Twitch channel, which is super cool. The last thing I wanted to mention is just that there's also a collection of like entertainment that's either created by Asian and Pacific Islander folks or featuring like protagonists telling different Asian and Pacific Islander stories. One of which that will probably come as no surprise is Life is Strange: True Colors is up there, along with a bunch of other different games and movies. I personally haven't played Life is Strange: True Colors. I've been hearing amazing things, so that is on my to playlist this weekend. So
sweet.
Yep.
Sweet. Jeff, what do you got for you? Got some couple of highlights before we get into
there's
the interviews.
There's quite a few, actually. Yeah, let's roll into. Slow down. Let's enjoy ourselves here.
Let's take a breath.
Easy.
Yeah, Larry. We're not. Are you renting out your office afterwards? Like, I got to get out of here. They're going to be doing a Monopoly.
No, I'm respectful because you guys, both of you. Have tremendously stressful and important and busy regular jobs. And I want to make sure you can get back to do those
jobs. Yeah,
sometimes
we're hanging out with you and we're pretending to be you for an hour. So let us enjoy the luxurious life of Major Nelson.
Go ahead.
Is that the book? Is that the book title? It should be. Okay, Lux. So we're going to, one of the guests is going to be Tom French, who's the multiplayer lead for Halo Infinite. And he'll be talking about season 2, Lone Wolves. A lot of information there over on Xbox Wire and, of course, over on Halo Waypoint. We're having a lot of fun with it, but you'll learn a lot more here in a minute. Also, you're going to be speaking to someone about the May update, new features and functionality coming to both your Xbox console and to the associated.
If I say QoS, do you tilt your head and go, what? You're going to learn about QoS, among many other things as well.
Absolutely.
QoS-ant.
Ooh, no, I like where you're going with this.
He's talking French. I'm sorry.
That's what I was looking at this. Way to connect the dots.
So, you guys are smart. You're all real smart. All right, so let's talk about Xbox Game Pass. So I did mention Loot River. A couple other games coming this week. One is, we got a little bit of New York. Love
Thank
it.
You. Thank you.
Ayudin Chronicle Rising. Which is a predecessor to a future RPG that's going to be coming out called Ayudin Chronicle. There's going to be some really interesting connections between the two. I'll be playing that. That's out next week, the date was confirmed this week. And so we'll be talking more about it. I actually might be doing a stream. That'll be out May 10th. By the time you listen to this, though, you'll be able to play Trek to Yomi, which is a cinematic game where you get to live your best samurai life, which may also be another title of Larry's book. And then Citizen Sleeper, which looks really interesting. It's a classic tabletop RPG, an action RPG with a spacefaring story. You're on the run from a corporation, you know, like you do. You know, that owns your artificial body. This really reminds me a lot of Cyberpunk at this point. You build alliances, you hack into the station, and you find secrets. So there's that and more available this week and next week with Xbox Game Pass. And then, Danganronpa 2. If you know what that means, you're like, oh, this is awesome that it's out on Xbox. And if you don't know what it means, you can check it out because it's part of Game Pass. So, you know, you don't need me. You can just try it. Really interesting addition to Xbox Cloud Gaming. One of the biggest games of the world, Fortnite Battle Royale, is now available wherever you are. If you've got access to a browser and you go to xbox.com/play, there is in across 26 countries as part of the Xbox Cloud Gaming beta, you can play Fortnite. And you don't need to even be a subscriber to anything. You just basically sign in with your Xbox ID and it's there. And we have an article with some more details over on Xbox Wire, but this is the first free-to-play game, like entirely free-to-play game, to be available through cloud gaming. And the team is investigating in, you know, potentially.
And I'll have someone on from the xCloud team next week to talk a little bit about what that means. So stay tuned.
Stay tuned. Nice. But if you're hearing this right now and you're like, oh, I'm on the road, I would like to play Fortnite where I'm at with touch controls. Okay. Xbox.com/play works on iOS, works on Android, works on browsers, works wherever you're at. So very cool. Next up, the Deep Pink Xbox wireless controller is announced this week and is beautiful. Now available for $64.99. Here's the pitch on this one. It's beautiful.
It's pink.
That's it. It just looks awesome. It's really nice. I really want it. During the Xbox One generation, we had sort of a dusky pink. It was sort of a similar color, but then it like had a
gradient.
What would you call it? An ombre, a gradient that went into dark.
Oh, I remember that. Yeah.
And that was actually, I probably have it over here. And that was nice, but I think this one, just like the solid color of the deep pink, is just, it's just beautiful. Hopefully we're looking at pictures of that as opposed to me describing something that looks really good.
Yeah, just show the pictures.
Also, something that looks really good and something that you can win, can't buy. We created a series of a Lego Star Wars Skywalker Saga Xbox Series X consoles. We had talked about this game frequently over the course of the last month or so. Really cool sort of reinvention of the Lego Star Wars series with tons and tons of content. Well, there are now a series of during the sweepstakes of consoles that you can win, each one focusing on
a series of Series S.
Exactly. Everything from like, there's like a Darth Maul one that is black and red, like you would imagine, and a Kylo Ren, also black and red. But then like, let's say like a Yoda one that's green, and a Stormtrooper one that's white. And it just looks really cool. So
because it was May the 4th last week.
Oh yes. May the 4th, followed by Cinco de Mayo, which is one of the more celebratory weeks, I would say. We should really have the whole week off. I think that's
lightsaber shaped nachos.
Yes, and for Cinco de Mayo, you want to check out Forza Horizon 5, by the way, where there's some new colorful decorations throughout the city. And there's cool stuff as part of Series 7, new murals, things of that nature. Last thing I want to call out, really wish I was there, but we've talked about Miami. This is the first Miami Grand Prix in several years. That was definitely a thing like when I lived there back in the 90s.
So did you actually go to the Miami Grand Prix?
No, you couldn't get anywhere near it because I was like 12. I couldn't drive down there. But all right, so here's the cool thing about it. We have teamed up with Alpine, which is one of the F1 teams, and we're calling it the Fast Track to PC Game Pass Challenge. So there's an F1 car on the Alpine team where we have put a series of QR codes on it. And so as you're watching the race, whether you're going in person or you're watching on TV, as these cars go by that have the QR code, if you can scan it, you might be able to win a 1 month, 3 month, or 6 month Xbox Game Pass subscription. So yes,
yeah.
So
I hope your phone
is charged. I hope you've got your high resolution. You know, you've got your big screen TV. It'd be really interesting to see if you do end up scoring 3 months of Game Pass. Let us know.
Let us know.
I think it's a really fun idea. Yeah. But it'll be on the A522 cars. There's two of them, and just waiting to be scanned. So good luck to you, and good luck to Team Alpine at the Miami Grand Prix.
Fun. What else you got?
More? What more? We've got QR codes on race cars, Larry. That's where I peek.
All right. I guess that's pretty much. Well, why don't we do this? Why don't we, I've got the interviews queued up, Jeff. So can you bring us into the interviews so we can learn more about Halo and networking?
Sure. First thing we're going to do is talk to Tom French. As we mentioned, he's the multiplayer creative director for Halo Infinite, talking all about Lone Wolves, which is Halo Infinite's season 2. And then we're going to be talking to Darrin Veit about, what is Quas? I don't know what Quas is. Darrin Veit, please let us know, because we have it now.
Halo Infinite Season 2 Lone Wolves is on this week. Joining me is the amazing Mr. Tom French. We had you on at the launch last year. Tom, welcome back to the show.
Thanks for having me back, sir. It's good to see you again.
It has been. It's great to see you. It's been a great, 6 months, 5 months? I mean, you guys have been, it's been many years, but I'm just saying it's been in the public hands for 5 or 6 months now, right? Depending upon if you want to include the technical multiplayer action.
Yeah. It's good to, it's good to get the game out there. It's good to get another season under our belt and kind of keep the team moving. We're doing a lot of planning and design work and, just constantly trying to make the game better and improve things for the players.
For those folks that haven't had a chance to check it out yet, let's go through some of the things, because this update's fairly substantial. You've got new modes, new maps. You've certainly done a lot of tweaks to the big core gameplay. But tell us, let's start off right off with the new maps, because they're looking pretty great.
Yeah, I'm pretty excited about the new maps. There's two new maps. So there's Breaker, which is it's kind of a smaller scale BTB map. But one of the things we're really excited about that map was we've been wanting to get more dynamic elements into the map. And so this map has this giant laser that cuts through the level, and it's on a timer and it pivots back and forth, and it crosses a big giant chasm.
Right.
And so it creates this fun little risk reward loop, especially when you're playing like Capture the Flag. If you're, loading up your Warthog with your buddies and you're trying to race back home with your flag, you have that little risk moment if that laser's up that you get your Warthog snagged and exploded halfway across it. So it's just kind of a fun, and it creates, what I love about it is it kind of encompasses the theme of the map, right? Like you feel the vibe of this thing, and it's this big giant banished play space. And it's got really cool lanes. It's kind of a 3-lane map. But it's just fun. It has the themes really baked in. The environment's really interesting to move around. And then our arena map is Catalyst, which is a symmetrical flag map, which is great. We really needed more flag maps in our game. It was something we really wanted to get out there. Our designer, Tyler, that designed the map, I think did a great job. It has really interesting flows to it. It has this bridge across the center of it, the top center of it, that's like a high risk, high reward moment. Like you can take the flag directly from your base to the other base in a straight beeline, but you're a big sitting duck target in the middle of it. And I think it has some really cool dynamics to the way that changes the shift of a match and how you flow through it and how you make decisions about how you use the space to kind of, run a flag or play an objective like that. There's all kinds of just interesting nooks and crannies. And then on top of that, I think the art came out incredible. It's gorgeous. It's like old ancient Forerunner. It's kind of stunning to look at when you're playing.
I have to tell you, I played a little bit of Breaker last night in Big Team Battle, which I love going into. And this is a map you really need to spend some time with. There's a lot of verticality to it. I was really stunned at, there's a lot of little ledges you can clamber up on. There's some areas you can jump over to, this whole area down below, which, most of our battle action was taking place at the surface level, but there is a lot of activity down below, right?
Yeah. That map's got layers to it, which is something I really love. Yeah. Like the top, that, especially that top center area, right? There's a big kind of open courtyard where the laser's cutting through and there's the catwalks going on each side. And it's just, so that's kind of the high intensity combat area, but there's definitely little avenues to duck out, go scavenge, find gear and loot and kind of work your way around or flank enemy positions.
Now we've also got, there's a new battle pass. We'll talk about that in a minute, but you've also got a couple of new game modes that some may be familiar to Halo fans. Some may not be, you've tweaked some things. Tell us about the new game modes.
Yeah, so there's three main core game modes this season. There's King of the Hill, which is kind of a return of the classic. We definitely put a little bit of an infinite twist on it. One of the things that when our designers were working on that was thinking about, like, classically, it was like what we would call like a drip score. So every moment you're standing in the hill, you get a point. And what it created this was these kind of snowball moments. And we also want to have these kind of definitive scoring moments in Infinite where very discreetly where like the team scores. And so we changed it from kind of the drip score model to you fill up a meter and then your team scores a point. So you have that very definitive like scoring moment.
Right.
So it changes the twist of the flow. It's not overly drastic. It's still basically the same amount of points to win a match.
It's more of an evolution.
It's like I said, we kind of like to put little twists on it. And then you can play the classic version of the drip score model version in custom games and things like that. Last Spartan Standing is a new mode that our designer Zach built that I think it came out really great. Like we wanted to build to fit the theme of the season. We wanted to have something that's really about you being a lone wolf, right? And so It's a free-for-all mode. We built it on our BTB maps to kind of give a little bit of extra breath and space. And then that let us support up to 12 players. 24 players we tried, and it was just way too chaotic. But then when you play it, like, you know, it's really about you. And then we tried to take kind of, you know, learning some of the twists that we had with, like, attrition and things like that, or even kind of if you look at, like, a Battle Royale game, that kind of elimination feeling. So we have things like we brought the danger zone from attrition, and then we kind of, instead of to prevent people from turtling, there's basically a light kind of what in Halo would be called like escalation or like a gun game mechanic from other games. So we kind of encourage players to go out and fight, because if they fight, they earn personal score, and personal score fills up or completes levels. And when you complete levels, you can switch your loadout and kind of play with a different gun, which is super fun. And kind of, it's a different twist on things, and it creates these really fun, you know, these elimination moments and that kind of triumphing up the ladder kind of feel. I played it for about 4 hours last night, and got some good games and finally got my W, which was good. So
now there's a whole other things in your patch notes. I'm looking at the patch notes right now at support.halowaypoint.com. You know, you've worked on bots. There's one that was actually interesting, some player outline options, which I really liked, because you've always had the option to kind of decide what colors are the enemies, the good guys and the bad mm-hmm. guys, or the enemies in your team. But now you can kind of put a outline on them, right?
Yeah, I mean, like some players for accessibility reasons couldn't see the outlines as well. And so we wanted to kind of give them tools to tune and tweak them, or just really to your personal liking. Like some people want to turn them off. Like some people want to have that, like, they don't want the distraction of the UI kind of interfacing on there. So it just gives players choice and options to tune the game to how they want to play it.
You've also done some weapon buffs and some, I don't want to say nerf because that's not fair, but you've kind of tweaked the weapons a little bit. I don't know if you could tell us a little bit about that as well.
Yeah, our sandbox team, you know, we're looking at like constantly looking at the balance of the game and trying to figure out where can we improve a weapon? Where do we need to actually, you know, nerf a weapon or something like that? And so it's something we're constantly in a state of discussing, and we're really looking to move to a model where we're actually kind of constantly kind of addressing concerns and balance issues of the game. And so it's something that team is really working on, building out a pipeline for how they're going to be doing that, or not a pipeline, but the process for how we'll be kind of constantly being able to look at what the community is doing and reacting, and, you know, sometimes shifting the meta, sometimes just you know, fixing something that maybe wasn't intentional, or where we're seeing something in the wild where people are doing something either that we didn't expect, or it's become overpowered or underpowered for that matter.
I have to ask you a question. Is there an internal term for the sword and the grapple meta?
One of the designers that worked on that, like the grapple shot, like he was his playtest, he was the grapple man. So it was always like you got grapple manned, or there's always some sort of term about being grapple manned when you got killed with a grapple hook in any combination of weapons.
Good to know. I want to get that out there. There's a lot of other things we talked about. Some of the weapons. I mean, I also noticed that, was it the Ravager? Did you guys buff up the Ravager a little bit? It feels like it's got a little bit more oomph to it.
So, yeah, the Ravager actually had some, it was kind of definitely underpowered when we launched. And so the charge shot, the area of effect stuff is actually working better than it was, you know, it did at launch. And so it definitely feels buffer. And especially in our bigger maps, like big team battle and stuff like that, or even in our social playlist, like it's definitely something you want to kind of put your hands on a little bit more to get some kills.
Yeah, because I noticed like in the, you know, prior to the update, it was kind of like, you know, in the camp, because this weapon also exists in the campaign. In the campaign, the brutes were like one-shotting me from across the map. Like, what is going on here? So hopefully I can have that similar level of accuracy. One of the other areas I noticed was some of the equipment. Some of the, you know, for instance, the shield feels like it deploys quicker and it feels like it's more sturdier. Is that accurate?
Yeah, I mean, trying to find the right balance for that thing in the game. You know, we have, like, there's the competitive part of the game where you really got to be very sensitive to, like, you know, timing issues and things like that. And so they've done a lot of massaging. And I think they found a good spot to give. People, we're just finding basically it was underutilized in the arena multiplayer sandbox. And so we wanted to kind of move it towards a more balanced position so people are going to be using it and deploying it in combat more.
Yeah, and I want to make sure it's the barrier that you can deploy. It's not your Spartan shield. Yeah, I just want to make sure. Leave me alone in the comments, gang. I mean, there's a ton of other improvements. One thing I noticed in the patch notes is my Xbox Series S will now gets a frame rate increase.
That's pretty awesome. I mean, that little box, like, smokes. Like, we've got one downstairs in my house, and, like, I play it on it, like, I don't know, all over the Christmas break. That was my main console. So, yeah, I love the fact that we can do that and really, you know, support those players that are looking for that high frame rate, especially when you're playing, like, you know, a sweaty multiplayer match and you're using that box. You want to be competitive in that space.
You know, it's there's again, I don't want to go through section by section, but all of the update is also, you know, obviously on Xbox Series X and S and on the console side, but you've also done the improvements on the PC side as well, right?
Yeah, we're moving the needle everywhere in the game right now. Like, there's the whole team is actively pulling the game forward and kind of, you know, fixing things here and fixing things there. So it's really about the total effort and the fact that we're really just trying to embrace PC as a, you know, a primary platform for Halo in a big, massive way. It's important to us to keep our players and fans playing the game.
And I know that there's, you know, we talked about the battle pass and things, and that's not really you're more of the gameplay. You've got a whole other team that works on the battle pass side of it. But I mean, there's all sorts of new cosmetics in the battle pass or that you can unlock. The game just keeps going on. It's funny because I was talking with some friends of mine, and we, you know, I don't know if you see this, Tom, because I think you and I are on each other's friends list, is, you know, I play this game probably like every night for like 20, 30 minutes. It's great to drop in with a Fiesta map or a couple of big team battles, and then, you know, everybody kind of goes their own way and goes back to Elden Ring. but it's really been great to see what you guys have done over the past few months. And I know that, you know, Infinite, it says it in the name, Halo Infinite. You guys have a pretty long roadmap for the coming months and years. It's going to be quite a while, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot we want to do with this game and the way we want to keep evolving. And I think I'm excited about this season because there's a lot of things that we'll be doing to kind of keep the game alive dynamically. Like, we're going to be doing a lot more playlist updating and kind of, like, you can see, like, the Rumble Pit playlist that we launched last night is kind of a start to how we want to kind of flesh out our playlist story and have more interesting playlists for people to kind of dip their toe in. If you want to, you know, go have a beer after work and go play a round of, you know, Oddball Slayer, or, like, we have kind of more wacky variants in Rumble Pit. Like, there is ninjas and, or it's called Ninja Slayer. So there's swords and grapple shots that you can fly around the map with. So trying to make sure we're catering to kind of a lot of different people with the game. But yeah, we want to kind of keep churning that content and kind of keeping the game fresh and exciting. So, and then, you know, and then building that roadmap towards the future of, like, what new game modes, what new maps will be coming, and kind of making sure we're plotting that and making sure that we're doing what's right for the game and also, like, what's right by the community ultimately. And then, but just also, like, we want to make sure we're there. Like, you know, you ship the game, we're tired, we're kind of pulling ourselves back out of the muck a little bit. But we're really plotting ahead and what we want to be doing in the next couple of years of our lives.
And what's also great is, like we've talked about in the past, this is a free to play game. First time a Halo multiplayer is free to play. So being the barrier to entry for you, anyone who hasn't played it, is pretty low. Go in and check it out and see what it's all about. And there's probably a playlist for you. Right. You know, you talked about all the wacky playlists, yeah. And of course, this the standard big team and Slayer and so forth. But there's always something for you in that playlist. Just make sure you scroll up and down and find some. Go shop around.
Yeah, that's kind of what we want is, like, we want, you know, we think about, like, just personalities of players. Right. And, like, if you're just looking for something quick, your 30 minute experience, you want to go in and romp around in big team battle, or you want to do something a little more solo, there's definitely experiences across, or you want to kind of grind and rank up in ranked, like, there's something for you, like, when you dive into the game.
I also want to point out that, like, for instance, you've got those two new maps that you talked about earlier, and one of the maps is a big team battle map. I assume you go into the big team battle hopper and kind of prioritize that it's going to show up more frequently, since that's what people want to play. Is that accurate?
Yeah, we did a lot of like what we called, like, playlist tuning this time around. We really put a lot of thought into, like, okay, this is a new map or this is a new mode. You know, like, how do we players might be excited about just wanting to play the new thing. So how do we just put that up in its own playlist for a little while and let it be temporary up there? Or like the breaker map, it's weighted higher, so you're getting higher chances. Or King of the Hill has a slightly extra buff on its weight, so it's going to roll into the mix a little bit more, so you're seeing it more frequently.
I have to tell you, I went through the entire patch notes, and it's amazing what you guys have done. The biggest disappointment for me, though, you know, because as a Halo fan, you always got to be disappointed slightly with something, right? is that at prior to the update, there was a black screen that you'd randomly come across unloading, getting into a match, and you could actually shoot and control your Spartan. And then when it would go to the cutscene of this, you know, everybody getting ready, the ready up area, you know, your Spartan may be over like 30 feet that way, turned around, looking at the ground. I mean, it was kind of awesome. So I'm bummed that you patched it, but I understand why.
Yeah, I think, like, you know, some of those things are funny and they're charming. I think sometimes they're a little less charming to the people that work on the systems. They're like, you know, they're like shaking their fist in madness. That one also, like, there's also competitive concerns to that. Like, you could be off spawn and kind of in the wrong location,
right?
And, you know, put yourself in a weird spot. So, you know, sometimes quirks and bugs lead to some fun little things, and you patch them for reasons. So yeah.
Totally get it. But anyway, listen, Tom, I appreciate you coming on and talking about the season. It's amazing. Halo Infinite Season 2 Lone Wolves available now. Go check it out. Halo 2 multiplayer, free to play. Tom, always good to see you. Congratulations to you and the team on getting Season 2 out there, and we'll have you on again soon, right?
I'm hoping soon, yeah. And then hopefully I'll see you online tonight.
Thanks.
Cool. Talk to you later.
Xbox Series X and S had a system update this week, and one of the interesting features was the quality of service tagging. And joining us right now from the Xbox team engineering is Darrin Veit. Darrin, good to see you.
Hey, good to see you as well, Larry. Thanks for having me.
Good. You and I have chatted a lot on email internally because, you know, I'm a kind of a network nerd, and you're a network kind of way more expert nerdy than I am. But I wanted to talk a little bit about what this feature is. We announced it earlier this week as part of the May update, and a lot of folks may be looking at this inside their settings. There's some other features as well, but specifically want to talk about the quality of service tagging. Tell us what that is, and tell us a little more about that and what it means for gamers.
Yeah, so quality service tagging is a feature that you can enable on your console, and there's a couple of options. There's one, it's called DSCP tagging, and there's another, it's called WMM tagging. So DSCP tagging is taking outbound network traffic for latency-sensitive applications like party chat, multiplayer, and supported games. And essentially, it's identifying the traffic to different network devices to say, hey, this is a latency sensitive type application. And so on supported networks, what it can enable is that when you have network congestion, that it can actually take the packets that are tagged and put them to the front of the line to help them not be impacted by slowdowns, latency, loss, things like that that you hit when you get network congestion.
So to your point, and we're going to walk through it on my console right here and how people, you know, turn it on and so forth. But to your point is that, you know, networks are complicated. People just plug it in, get an IP address, and get a Wi-Fi signal, and they're on their way. But there's a lot going on behind the scenes, as you talked about, with network packets and things like that. And this allows the Xbox to basically tell whatever kind of network you have, if it's supported, that, hey, I've got some pretty important stuff here. Make sure you prioritize it versus maybe a family member in the other room watching a Netflix stream or browsing the internet, right? This kind of puts it to the top of the queue.
Yeah, that's a great scenario. And what you can think of it as is that under ideal situations, you shouldn't see much of a difference with quad tagging turned on or off. But it's the times when you start having contention, like a wireless network environment where, a perfect example, that I'm playing multiplayer game on my Xbox, and then all of a sudden two or three folks in the same family network start streaming video and starts adding contention on the network. And so that's in those scenarios that for WMM, for Wi-Fi, with that tagging enabled, it actually allows more time for the latency sensitive traffic to actually communicate. And so in situations where you normally might see a slowdown or start seeing some lag within the game, it can actually protect from that happening.
Let's go through the feature right now. So let me bring up, this is actually my console on my Xbox Series S here on my desk. People just, you know, once they take the system update, they're going to go into settings, and then you can see I've got network settings right here at the top, and then they have to go over to advanced. Now let's talk about some of these things. I mean, I kind of blurred some things out here because, you know, I don't want people coming into my network. But we've got like things like alternate MAC address. Tell us about that before we get down to the QoS tagging settings at the bottom. What are some of these things mean?
Yeah, so the alternate MAC address, it's been around for a while on Xbox.
Yeah.
So this is primarily used for when you connect to managed networks. And so a lot of times you can think of like a hotel network, hospital, where they have a allow listing based off of your MAC address. And this would allow you to take a device that has already been allow listed on that network and clone its MAC address over to your Xbox so that it can join the network. We also added some functionality a while back that can detect, it's called a captive portal.
And I'm so excited about that feature because I don't know if you remember, but I was really pushing for that feature internally for a long time.
Yeah, it was something that we were really excited to add. And so that's where you can detect when I connect to a network where it would normally, like if you have a laptop or phone, it would automatically open up a browser window to a page where you would provide your credentials or accept the terms of use.
Right.
And so on Xbox, when you hit one of those captive portal networks, we automatically detect it, pop open a browser window so that you can authenticate or do whatever steps you need in order to join that network. And then automatically connect. And so, yeah, most scenarios you'll be using that captive portal flow, but then you also have the alternate MAC address as a secondary mechanism to join one of those restricted type networks.
The right below, we've got alternate port selection. Now tell us what that is, because right now you can see I'm on port 3074. So ports, just for a high level, ports are kind of like exactly that. Their information goes through different ports in your network. So like, I think web browsers at 80, correct? If memory serves correctly.
Yeah, I think one of the best analogies I heard was think of it like sending a letter to somebody is that you've got your address and then your port. So you got your IP address would be like the address of the building and the port would be like the apartment number. And okay. So which door am I going to at that address? And so the alternate port selection, it's a handy feature for network environments that for one reason or another, automatic port selection isn't working. And so 3074 is the port that is registered for Xbox. It's been around for a very long time, probably since the original Xbox. And so it's well known. But in networks where your console is unable to automatically map that port to your router using UPnP, a lot of folks will do a workaround of doing like port forwarding or port triggering is something that you may have heard to be able to open up your NAT type for multiplayer games.
Yeah.
The alternate port selection allows you to fall back to a different port from the 3074. So if you have multiple Xbox consoles within a home network where UPnP isn't working, you can set them up on different ports so that they're not colliding. You can set up a port forwarding rule for each individual console. So that's what that is for.
Yeah, so basically if I have one console upstairs and one downstairs or another room, I can put one on 3074, one on 3088, you know, and then in my router, I have to go in and basically say, you go here and you go here.
Exactly. Okay. Yeah, and it's kind of nice because that flows into the QoS settings is that QoS tagging will be happening on traffic that is using that port.
So let's go down to QoS tagging here because this is really the net new feature down here at the bottom. And it's a pretty simple looking screen. You turn it on, you turn it off, and you hit apply. But tell us what each of these are, DSCP tagging and WMM tagging.
Yeah, so DSCP tagging happens at the IP layer. So this is for both IPv4 and IPv6 traffic. And so that is where I set a value that identifies it that, hey, this is latency sensitive traffic. So it will carry on beyond your home network. So it will go through your router and actually out to your ISP. So that works
well. So that option actually tells my ISP, hey, my Xbox, this is my Xbox multiplayer traffic, please prioritize it.
Yeah, and you know, it's up to the ISP to actually leverage that, but there are some new technologies coming out. One of them is called low latency DOCSIS, which is a protocol that's used by cable providers for internet service. So if you have like a cable modem, that's a good indication that you're using DOCSIS. So it's a new protocol that takes advantage of the DSCP marking and can identify that and give it prioritization when there are times of congestion within a portion of the ISP network.
Got it. So that's cool.
Yeah, it's so it'll work for that. Also, a lot of folks will have home routers that have a quality of service engine, and so it can also help identify traffic to those devices to help prioritize it within the home network. And then for nerds like Larry that have the really fancy networks, he can go on there and just go crazy with it.
Yeah. But it's really great is that we've added these options because it helps gaming get better. And one of the interesting things you're telling me before we started the interview was a lot of older games that really predate this technology or this concept can now leverage it through backwards compatibility. Tell us a little bit about that, because that's really cool.
Yeah, so that was really cool that we were able to build off of the amazing work that our backwards compatibility team has done over the years. And so it's not only current generation titles, but also games that came out during the Xbox One generation, as well as going back to Xbox 360, can all leverage the packet tagging feature. And so it's a pretty crazy scenario that you can actually be playing a game that years and years ago, no one was really thinking about doing any type of packet tagging, and then automatically gets done within the Xbox system and can take advantage of, newer generation technologies in the networking space. So yeah, it's a really cool feature.
So the wizards of backwards compatibility continue to give us the bounty and gifts, right? In this way, yes. Again, because of the way that team created the emulators and the containers they run in, is they just kind of get dropped in and start communicating with the console, and the console does all the heavy lifting.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's really exciting. Now, I got to let you go in just a minute here, but what are some, you and I could talk for hours, and again, we'll be emailing. But tell us a couple of tips maybe that you can give folks about how to optimize their network. Of course, best is always hardwired and things like that.
Yeah, a good rule of thumb is that wired is going to be your preference. And a lot of folks may not be aware that wired is more than just like an Ethernet cable, that there are options like power line adapters, MoCA for using coax cabling.
I actually use MoCA at home. I use my MoCA here.
They actually got some MoCA adapters back here that I've used and test with folks' different network environments. So wired, including non-traditional wired connections that you may not be aware of, is preferred. And then for Wi-Fi, there's two different radio bands that routers have. It's 5 gigahertz and 2.4 gigahertz. A lot of folks may not be aware of the differences. 5 gigahertz is preferred over 2.4 in a lot of scenarios. Even though 5 gigahertz has shorter range, that typically also means less overlap with other networks. And so in 2.4, you may be able to get a stronger radio signal between your console and your router. But a lot of times you'll also be overlapping with a bunch of other networks from your neighbors, neighborhood, and things like that, and actually run into congestion.
Yeah, it's interesting you say that, because there's so much noise on a 2.4 gigahertz. It could be a smart plug or, all these different things are running on, because chips are so inexpensive right now for 2.4 gigahertz that they put them in everything. And sometimes,
yeah, and actually, it's not just Wi-Fi. Like, one of the things that blows my mind is a microwave oven can actually cause noise in the 2.4 gigahertz
right.
range.
Even though because it's not about trying to communicate. It's more about that microwaves. The function of microwave cooking is in that range, right?
Yeah,
fascinating. And then, of course, one of the things we always want to do, and I'm going to go back to the dashboard here in just a second, is in in your network settings, is over on the right hand side there. That's what you want. You want to have IPv4 and hopefully IPv6 if your ISP and your network supports it. But your NAT type being open, that's kind of the holy grail, isn't it?
Yeah. So NAT type being open, that comes into play for games that are actually peer to peer. And so you also have games that are server hosted, especially sure. a lot of the very large scale multiplayer. And so, yeah, the NAT type comes into play for IPv4 connectivity for games that are actually connecting console to console to run the session.
Yeah. So it's great stuff there. Anyway, Darrin, I got to let you go. You and I could go on forever about this. I'd love to have you on again to talk more about networking, and hopefully people understand the new feature that's now available, quality of service tagging, that hopefully will help your multiplayer gaming, and frankly, some maybe even your backwards compatibility gaming, just a little bit better, because every little millisecond counts, doesn't it, Darrin?
Awesome. Yeah, absolutely. Thanks a lot, Larry.
All right. Thank you, my friend.
Thank you to Darrin and Tom for those interviews. Good to know that QoS stands for quality of service and not croissants, but now I could really use a croissant. So
little ham and cheese croissant.
Sounds nice.
Jeff, are you okay with that?
Are
you the only one allowed to make bad jokes here? Yeah. I'm the French
pastry. Here's the thing that you don't know about Rebecca is she has like a PhD in bad jokes and dad jokes, and I cannot even hold a candle to that.
Well, we had a great week. We're going to come back next week. We have even more interviews next week. Another great show we're getting ready for. You know, one thing we didn't talk about, Jeff, that we kind of had a blog post up earlier this week was about our showcase.
Oh, duh. Yeah.
We talked about that last week, didn't we? Oh, no, we didn't because we recorded on Wednesday and it got announced on Thursday.
Exactly.
I was like, that's last week's news. So
it is last week's news, but we haven't covered it properly in the show. So just we'll be talking more about that in the weeks coming up. So just as best
Sunday, June 12th, mark your calendars, 10 a.m. Pacific.
Very exciting.
Yeah. So we'll talk about that more in the future. But anyway, thank you both for taking time out of your busy weeks and busy schedules to join us. Thank you, dear listener and dear viewer.
Did you say schedule, Larry?
Yes.
Feeling very European today.
Well, we talked about croissants, so
it's, you must have had a Coca Light.
Schedules.
Stop it, you.
Au revoir.
Au revoir. Anyway, we'll talk to you guys. We'll talk to everybody next week. Thanks for downloading the show. Make sure you drop some comments either here over at YouTube. We'd love to do that. Jeff, anything you want to add before we go?
No, I've said more than enough.
All right, you too, Rebecca. I know you've said enough as well. Any final jokes before I let you go, Rebecca?
Don't forget to like and subscribe.
There we go. That's the way to end it. Good enough. All right, everybody. Okay. We'll see you guys next week. Bye, everybody.
Bye.